far as chronology goes, we have not gone very far away from last Sunday. Today's gospel lesson actually takes place on the same day as last week's lesson, and that is the story of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We actually had really great attendance at weekday services this week. It's surprising we had more people at most of our weekday services than we did during Lent, so I'm really glad that people wanted to come back and celebrate yet more Easter. And for those who were here during the weekday communion services, they heard a lot of readings that all took place on the actual day of the resurrection. Last week, of course, we heard the story about the women going to the tomb to anoint the body, and they found that the tomb was empty. Today's gospel lesson is the same exact day later on, but during the week, we heard the lesson about Jesus first appearing right after the lesson last week. Jesus appears to Mary Magdalene. She doesn't recognize him. She thinks he's the gardener. And a lot of books have had a lot of theological reasons why they think that she didn't recognize him. Quite frankly, I think it's human nature. Jesus was probably the last person in the world she expected to see alive and standing in front of him. It was only after he said her name, Mary, that she realized who was, and in fact it was the Lord. She rushes back and tells the disciples that she's seen the Lord. But yet they are still in the upper room and they are cowering with fear, as we heard in today's gospel lesson. Jesus, meanwhile, makes another appearance on the road to Emmaus. Some of the disciples are heading home after being in Israel, after being in Jerusalem for the celebration of Passover. And they're talking about what's happened that weekend. That this Jesus, who they thought was the Messiah, was arrested and he was crucified. And he died, and now they've heard rumors that he's risen from the dead. And Jesus comes up alongside them, and they don't recognize him. But Jesus then starts with the scriptures, and he fills in for them the whole story about how Christ must suffer and die and rise again to fulfill God's purpose for humanity. And as soon as Jesus breaks the bread, they realize just in the same way that we recognize Jesus under the species of bread and wine, the Holy Communion he's given to us. But now today, once again, we hear a story about Jesus appearing on that same day, now to all of those who are cowering in the upper room. They are fearful that the Jewish authorities are going to come after them next, or perhaps the Roman authorities for spreading rumors about Jesus' body being stolen. We have also about the body being stolen. And so they were fearful that perhaps they would come after them. And yet, it is Jesus who appears to them again and begins by telling them peace and not to be afraid. They recognize Jesus. They're looking for Jesus. And Jesus then does something remarkable and amazing. There's a lot of remarkable and amazing. But he breathes upon them. He gives them the gift of the Holy Spirit, and he begins them on the way of their work, of their mission, of their ministry. He breathes upon them, and he gives them the Holy Ghost, and he tells them that they are to go out into the world and to preach about reconciliation for the forgiveness of sins. Jesus' entire purpose coming to earth, the second person of the Holy Trinity, taking human flesh and dwelling among us, teaching, preaching, performing miracles, healing, all of those things ultimately teach us about the nature of God. But all of his life pointed towards the cross and the grave and the resurrection. Why? Because ultimately Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners. For 40 days during Lent, we looked at our sin. And I hope we made a good evaluation of the state of our soul, and we've confessed those sins to God, and we're making a good start on amendment of life. So too, for 40 days, we are now going to celebrate this resurrection and begin to figure out together how God is calling us same way that you told those disciples on the resurrection day that they were to preach and to teach about the forgiveness of sins. The entire ministry, the entire reason for Jesus' incarnation, his taking flesh, is so that we can be reconciled back to the Father. We are separated from God by sin, but we are joined again, and we have the opportunity for unity through the cross and the flesh of Jesus Christ. His death and resurrection has given us the ability to be forgiven. And we will spend the next 40 days learning how to pray and learning how to put into effect Jesus' teaching so that we can let the rest of the world know that Jesus Christ is Lord and that he loves humanity, he loves individuals, he loves people, and that their sins are forgiven. That's the formula, brothers and sisters. We acknowledge our faults and ask God for forgiveness. We acknowledge him as our Savior and our Lord, and we receive that forgiveness and we share it with other people. Jesus begins this model for ministry on the first day that he rose from the dead. This is not an afterthought. This is a day, oh, by the way, you should forgive sins. This becomes the central focus of how it is that both we are reconciled to God and how we can help other people to come into relationship with Jesus Christ through his reconciliation, his forgiveness of their sins. Yes, it may take a little time to convince other people they're sinful. They may have a lot of bravado, and they might think they don't need it. But your sharing the good news, combining with your praying for them, will help God the Holy Spirit as he speaks to them at night in the depth of their consciousness. And we know that it is God himself who will ultimately convict them of sin so that they become open to hearing the good news of God in Jesus Christ. Next week, we'll talk about the Good Shepherd, how Jesus is the Good Shepherd, and what that means for us again as a part of this model for ministry. But this week, brothers and sisters, I want you to pray not only in thanksgiving that you have been forgiven for your sins, but I want you to pray this week with an earnest desire to find ways to help other people to realize the love and the forgiveness of Jesus Christ. You are to pray this week with special intention that those people with whom are in your life, as well as those with whom you will interact this week, perhaps more than one time, that there will be an opportunity for you to share God's love and forgiveness. That's your prayer. Because what we know about prayer, brothers and sisters, is that when it is in our heart and in our mind, then it also can become action. Because we become open to how God is leading us and guiding us. This week we're going to pray in thanksgiving for our forgiveness. And we're going to ask God how it is that we can be a vessel for that forgiveness for other people. Jesus loves you so much that he died and rose from the dead. And he loves that next person that you will interact with. So let's ask God in loving prayer how it is that we can help them to hear and to see and to receive the good news that Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.